The path of a gun can be difficult, if not impossible, to trace. Our journey today starts with Colt Single Action Army, serial number 4552. Manufactured at Colt's factory in Hartford, it would need to pass inspection before its journey, and so came to the hands of a civilian employed by the War Department as a principal sub-inspector, a man named Orville W. Ainsworth, who performed that work for only a short time, 1873 to 1874. He, as he inspected it, would stamp his A monogram onto the various parts and then likely went on to the next. He had work to do, after all. The Ordnance Department had contracted Colt on June 23rd, 1873, for an order of 8,000 of what they called Colt's revolver, caliber 45. Almost all of Colt's early production of the 1873 went to satisfying this contract, partially in preparation for the Black Hills Expedition. Now, officially, this was a military reconnaissance mission deep into the heart of potentially hostile Sioux reservation to scout reservations for a new fort. Unofficially, they were looking for gold. From Colt's plant at Hartford, Connecticut, the revolvers were shipped to the Springfield Arsenal in lots of 1,000, who would then distribute them as ordered. Serial number 4552 was to be part of Colt's fifth shipment of 1,000 revolvers to Springfield. Known today as Lot 5, they were shipped on January 28, 1874, received by Springfield 3 days later, and by February 3rd, were ordered sent to the Rock Island Arsenal for use by the 7th U.S. Cavalry. There they would sit on that island in the Mississippi until early June 1874, when as many as 900 Colts were finally shipped from Rock Island Arsenal to the 7th Cav, who was waiting not so patiently at Fort Lincoln in the Dakota Territory. The shipment included approximately 600 Colts from Lot 5, 300 from Lot 6, and around 39 from Lot 7. In other words, most of the soldiers of the 7th Cavalry were armed with Colts from Lot 5. Now, the 10 companies of the 7th Cav were to escort the Black Hills Expedition as they surveyed and reconnoitered the Black Hills, which are better known to the Lakota Sioux as the Pahasapa, the sacred center of their universe. Unfortunately for the Sioux, gold was discovered, and the glitter of those minerals the men so desire marked the beginning of the end for their way of life. Within 2 years, the Great Sioux War of 1876 had begun. Very few revolvers were issued to the 7th Cav in that two-year interim from the beginning of the expedition to the beginning of the war, meaning that the vast majority of their originally issued revolvers from 1874 were still being carried. Now, on June 25th, 1876, that's a day well known to American history. It is entirely likely that on that date, this Colt entered the valley of the Little Bighorn River with Lieutenant Colonel George Custer and 12 companies of the 7th Cavalry. The five companies directly under Custer, all 212 souls, were slaughtered. The remaining seven companies fought a defensive battle for 2 days until they were finally reinforced, having no notion of their comrades' massacre. Those slain provided revolvers and Springfield carbines for their indigenous foes, and at a minimum, there were 252 revolvers of the fallen soldiers, and as many as 50 more which were discarded or dropped in the din of combat. This means that an estimated 300 plus Colt revolvers fell into Native American hands. In fact, the Colt sequentially numbered after this one, 4553, was only discovered in 1992 at the site of the battle. It is only one of three Custer revolvers archaeologically recovered from the battlefield. Now, of the remaining distributed to the 7th Cavalry, approximately 330 were returned to Fort Lincoln in the aftermath of the battle. 300 more had never left Fort Lincoln in the first place, but serial number 4552, it wasn't in any of those groups. Well, how do we know? Simply put, there was still a war going on, and all serviceable revolvers were still needed for duty. In fact, surviving Colts from the 7th Cavalry would continue to serve until 1893, when they began to be replaced by the new 38 caliber Colt revolvers. But the old peacemakers, they got recalled. And many of the 7th Cavalry's found their way back to the Rock Island Arsenal, where they were refurbished, converted to artillery models with 5.5-inch barrels, a process that in the repair often resulted in mismatched parts. But serial number 4552 shows no such treatment. It still carries its original 7.5-inch barrel. It has matching parts. Even its condition shows it escaped the almost 2 subsequent decades of military service that its counterparts would have endured. It's consistent. The original finish, the case hardening, polish marks. It's a condition consistent with a revolver in service for only 2 years. So if it didn't go back to the military, where did it go? The fact is, no one knows. It simply vanished. And for over 140 years, it has evaded researchers, collectors, historians, archaeological digs, and the Army. Serial number 4552 is not a known revolver. No books have documented it. It's not even recorded in the National Archives. So it gives me no small pleasure to say that very recently, the whereabouts of this historic revolver were finally revealed. And it was discovered in all places in Littleton, Colorado, by the good folks at Old Steel Historical Firearms. Joining me now from Old Steel is Sean Steele to tell us the next chapter in serial number 4552's remarkable story. Sean, welcome to set.
Pleasure to see you again.
So tell us, how did serial number 4552 walk through your door?
Yeah, you know, it's a fascinating story, and it every time I tell it, I recall the details of it, and it was so fun to have this walk through the door the way it did. So a little bit of a preamble. We have a small shop in Colorado where we deal with historical firearms, and it's wonderful. We're getting bigger. We had a family come through the door. It was a grandma and her daughter and husband, and they brought in a gun wrapped up in a blanket, right? It's typical. Stuff comes like that all the time, you know? So it's, okay, what are we going to have? Is this like a old gun? Is it something new? What do we got? So we open it up and we look at it, and it's, okay, single action. Nice. Single actions are always nice because they're good guns to have. And when I start looking at it, I'm running the counter, so I've got other stuff that I get to deal with at the time. And I look at this gun and I see the serial number and I clear it, and I make sure that it's safe and everything like you're supposed to do in a gun store. And I'm starting to look at the condition. It's beautiful, right? So we have a couple other people working with us who they're more into the historical stuff, like the single actions and things. So I asked them to come take a look at it with me, and they're interested as well. Now, nobody really knows at this time how monumental of a discovery this was for us, right?
Yeah.
So we get a chance to start looking at it, and we start looking in the book on it. You know, the family, we're kind of talking to them. Okay, where did you get it? Okay, my great-grandfather had a mercantile store, and Indian came in one day, said that he picked this up at the Custer Battlefield, and it's been our family ever since.
Sure.
Okay, is this a barn find? Is this somebody telling me a story? Mm-hmm. What's going on here? So we start looking through the book, and we see in the book, serial number 4553, backstrap and cylinder recovered off the battlefield. Okay. What was that serial number again? Oh, 4552. Close. So we started going through the process of talking to the people who know more about these things than we do, right? Because we deal with single actions. But to have something like this come through, we need to phone a friend on that one.
Sure.
And we did. So we contacted Mr. John Kopeck. You know, I gave him a phone call.
Perfect.
Mr. Kopeck, thank you very much for taking my call. He's kind of hard to get a hold of. Sent him a couple emails. And I said, sir, I have a gun here, serial number 4552. You know, I see in the book that you wrote that it is one off of one that was recovered. And he says, oh, well, I'll put your name down. I'll call you in a couple months. Okay, cool. I understand. The guy's busy.
Busy guy,
he's got a very, very, very hectic schedule. You got to do what you got to do. So I turn to our guy, Patrick, and I say, hey, Patrick, take me some pictures of this. And we'll take him to the print shop, print off some nice high-quality pictures, put it in an envelope, and I mailed it priority mail, watch the tracking on it, showed up at his house a couple days later, ready to take a look at that gun now.
He probably had the same reaction you did after seeing the serial number in the book and just,
You know, I can only imagine. Because, I mean, to have something like this show up, the forgeries happen, mm-hmm. you know? So I can understand a little bit of apprehension when you hear, hey, I have one of the most significant historical finds of this century. Mm-hmm. So, you know, people are going to be a little hesitant mm-hmm. to just walk into that. So I could understand that. What he did was he coordinated with us, and we had it sent out. And we put a tracker device inside a Pelican case that I went and bought.
Yeah.
Because when it showed up, it was wrapped up in some velvet, mm-hmm. right? Which is, you know, thank you for putting a nice soft cloth
Very
in
nice.
There. So they wrapped it up in velvet for us. I put it in a nice Pelican case, picked all the foam out, mm-hmm. and sent it off to him. And he got it, and he called me about 4 days later, said, this is done. Nice gun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, nice gun, he said. So he sent it back, and we got it back, and we read the letter, and we're going through it line by line. It was, you know, it was a big deal for us, because we all came together at the shop, you know, the owner, everybody, and we're reading this letter. It's like, what is this thing that we got here?
It is from essentially the authority on Colt for the last several decades, and you're about to find out a significance between those
exactly.
single digits.
Exactly.
Is it legit? Is it authentic?
And it was. You know, his letter says, and this was the biggest part, and this was the thing that really stood out to us. It's the last line on the letter that he wrote. Mm-hmm. The finest representation of a lot five that I've ever had the privilege to examine.
Oh my.
So for John Kopech, man who's been doing this, who wrote the book, who's been to the field, who has been in this arena for that long, to say that this is the nicest one that he's ever seen, that speaks for itself.
That's quite a testament. Quite a testament to the gun.
Absolutely.
So you've confirmed this with Mr. Kopech. You have the knowledge in the shop. What was the family's reaction to the news, who've been, you know, carrying this story for some time, to hear this potentially confirmed by Mr. Kopech?
They were thrilled.
Imagine
you know, that. They were thrilled, but I believe that they metered what they did. I'm sure that when they got home, it's like. But when we told them, you know, I explained it to them. I said, you know, this is a big deal. Mm-hmm. This is a very historically significant find. This is one of possibly the biggest ones that has happened this century. I said that to them, and they were excited. But for them, you know, you got to think they've had this in their family for this long. When they were kids, mm-hmm. the neighbor kids would come by and they'd want to look at it. Mom had to shoo them away and lock it up, and they had to bring it out and show it to them slowly. And it's like, okay, well, yeah, but don't touch it. Mm-hmm. You can look at it. You know, they said that it had been sitting on a desk drawer, mm-hmm. it had been sitting on a shelf, and then only recently did they start doing a little bit more research, because you know this has been in the family since before the internet. This has been in the family since before phones, even.
Oh my.
So for them to be able to take this and show it to the other people and the interest in it, it's understandable that they would want to keep care of it. So they had end up taking it and put it in a safe deposit box until they brought it out for us to take a look at it.
They clearly were excellent stewards and kept a fair number of those neighborhood kids away. I know when we had it out just prior to coming on, the condition of it is pretty stunning, with polished lines and touches of the case hardening is still on there. Pretty strong for a gun that's 150 years old.
Phenomenal.
It may have seen battlefield use, whether it's in the sight notch on the top strap. The gun is phenomenal. So they were excellent stewards of it for that period of time that they had it.
Plus, it being in Colorado helped too. Dry climate doesn't allow stuff to rust as bad.
Very true.
So, you know, the condition of this gun is impeccable. It's amazing to see what its history, its lineage, and to be a part of the process to bring it to light and mm-hmm. show it to collectors and to bring it into the historical community for research. You know, one of the other things that Mr. Kopech had said in his letter, that this is a new addition to the survey,
mm-hmm.
which means that as history is being written, as we recover things from historical times and try to decipher how did this get here, what steps did it take, our job as historians, as custodians of these artifacts, is to do the best due diligence we can to make sure that we can preserve as much of this information for the future generations to enjoy and learn. Because the trauma that the people experienced carrying these things in battle, you know, the fact that this gun is in such low use, there's many different theories that you could come up with how come this thing is in such good shape.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned our job as historians. I think that's something both our businesses share. And you've done the job. You've done the job. And to think that Old Steel and Rock Island Auction Company, because they don't find Lot 5 guns every day. They don't find guns that have been hiding for a century and a half. To think that when they talk about this in Colt Collector Books, when they add this to the survey,
Like, yeah, it was discovered in Littleton, Colorado, by this family, who took it to an old steel historical firearms in Littleton, Colorado, and ended up at Rock Island Auction Company and sold in May 2022. Like, that's part of the gun story now. I think it's fantastic. So when you've started communicating to the family what you have, how long did it take to maybe start investigating the value of other Custer era or Lot 5 Colt single action armies?
Well, that's a tough question.
Yeah.
Because there's not very many out there.
True.
And when you have an item like this, you know, a true barn find, there are barn finds out there. Mm-hmm. Things are going to continue to surface. Things that are found, from a sword discovered in an attic to a revolver discovered in a desk drawer. Things that have this immense intrinsic and historical value to it are going to continue to be found. So to answer your question, pretty soon after we received it, mm-hmm. our job is to consign things and mm-hmm. assist people to get the most that they can. You know, we assist our customers, our clients. So one of the first things you do is you start looking up price comps, right? Mm-hmm. And it's not as easy as just typing in Google single action Army Custer and getting a good result from it.
True.
You get some, you know, and then there's other documentaries, there's been artifacts and other things that have been recovered from the field that have sold for large sums of money.
Yes.
And for a lot of people, that's intimidating, you know, because mm-hmm. a lot of customers, when they hear that, they get concerned. And because, okay, who do we trust this piece to? Who do we allow into this family heirloom?
Valid.
Who do we allow to look at this? Who do we allow to take this? So our search for comparable items coming from the Custer battlefield, there's a lot of fakes.
Yes.
And there's a lot of people who say they have something. And there's a lot of people who say that this is a $50 million whatever.
Yeah.
Okay, is someone going to pay that? Mm-hmm. There's no way to tell. But we did quite a bit of research on various items mm-hmm. and artifacts pretty much as soon as we got this item. And while there are a lot of good examples, I could not find one that came close to the condition of this one.
As confirmed by Mr. Kopeck. So there's existing limited data, and then there's data on something fresh to market in a condition that nobody's ever seen before. So yeah, I can imagine estimating a price would have its difficulties.
I had some people coming through, because we have a few people who come through the shop, people
sure.
who would consider themselves experts, people who I would consider experts, and everybody had something to say about it. Anywhere from, oh, that's a $7,000 gun to that's a $250,000 mm-hmm. gun. So you have a wide range of many people's opinions and ideas as to what something like this is worth. Mm-hmm. And just like I said, when I was searching, I couldn't find anything really comparable. Because when it comes to this stage of an artifact like this, to where you have so few items available, to where you have so few instances of something selling and a condition so high, finding a comparable is not easy.
No.
Because there is none. This is it. This is the best one that there is.
And it is a beaut. So you told us how Old Steel came in to this phenomenal Colt. What was the family story? How did they come to acquire this heretofore unknown and exceptional Colt Single Action Army?
So the story as it was told to me, there was a mercantile store along the Platte River downtown Denver. Sometime turn of the century, early 1900s, mm-hmm. there was an Indian gentleman who had gotten off the train at the Union Station downtown in Denver and came to a mercantile stop and traded this gun to the shopkeeper for a pair of jeans and a blanket. And then from there, he wrapped it up in a blanket mm-hmm. and put it in a desk drawer where it sat for 100 years. And it was talked about. You know, they explained it to the family and say, grandfather explained to grandfather, this is what I got this from. This is what it is. Mm-hmm. This is yours now. You know, grandfather explains to father. Father explains to daughter. And then grandma, at this point, explained to daughter. Mm-hmm. And then they all came in and brought it to us. And we got a chance to see it firsthand and listen to their story and be a part of it. And we were able to understand that at the time that we got this, these people had no idea what they were talking about. They had no idea what they had. When these people came in through our door, we knew they weren't gun people. We knew they weren't collectors. They were an honest American family that came in with a beautiful piece. And we were able to assist them. We were able to get them the knowledge that they needed and protect them from a very cutthroat and sometimes predatory collector market.
Well, it's been a family heirloom for over a century. A little anxiety about entrusting it to somebody else is pretty understandable.
And they had told us before that they had tried to find a few other people to look at it. Mm-hmm. And there had been another appraisal that was done by a different shop that called it about $50,000, which for a single action in as good a condition as this, without any historical provenance, is understandable as a price. So they enlisted us to assist them.
Sean, thank you so much for telling us the most recent chapter of this Colt story. I think a lot of Colt collectors are going to be very, very excited about 4552.
I can tell you we're very excited about it, as is the family. We're going to be very excited to see what happens to it. We're going to see so many amazing things come out, whether it's entries into historical archives, information comes out, maybe other people know something. It's exciting to see the process and development of this piece's story as it travels through history. And to be able to play a small role in that development is a huge privilege. Thank you.
Thank you.
And collectors should be over the moon over this Colt. It is an absolutely fantastic history, and it's so rare to know a gun's history from start to finish. It's truly a special circumstance. But even with its historical associations at its heart, it is an absolutely extraordinary Colt. 4-digit serial number, it's early production. Always desirable by collectors. It's Ainsworth inspected. Now, he only inspected up to about 13 or 12,000 serial number, only of which 10% of his guns are known to exist today. So it's one of already 12 or 1300 available to Colt collectors. It remains, of course, as we mentioned, unconverted in its original cavalry model length barrel. It has matching parts. The serial number for the cylinder still matches, of course, those found on other parts of the gun. And after being hidden for nearly a century and a half, it is a fresh entity in the world of fine arms collecting. And after our May 13th through 15th premier firearms auction, it'll begin the next chapter of its journey. And we'll find out which world-class collector will be the very first to call it theirs after over 140 years of obscurity.